So today's video is finally gonna be the finale of Valencrimes week. I'm sorry this video is coming like 3 days late. If you've been following my channel for a while, you will know I am not good with schedules and, you know, keeping them. And I used to really, really stress myself out about it, but this time I've just kind of taken a step back and been like, look, quality over quantity. And I wanted to spend a bit more time on this one. I wanted to research it further. I wanted to get as much as I could in this video. So I thought instead of rushing it and getting it out on time, I'd just take my time. And a lot of you said that you would prefer it that way. So yeah, I'm sorry it's coming a little bit late, but it's better now than it would have been if I would have got it up on time, so. And this one fits the theme perfectly. Today we are gonna be talking about the Grindr Killer. So quickly before I get into this video, I just wanna give my usual disclaimer that I mean absolutely no disrespect to anyone that I talk about in this video. This video is for educational purposes and everything that I'm about to say is just information that I have found on the internet and I'm compiling into one video. In July of 2014, 22-year-old Gabriel Cavari had recently split up with his long-term boyfriend Thierry. Gabriel was originally from Slovakia, but he moved to London sometime prior and he ended up living with his boyfriend Thierry. But now that they'd split up, Gabriel was gonna have to find somewhere else. And as you can imagine, this situation was kind of awkward. He was living with his ex-boyfriend, and so he didn't really have time to rent a place, find a new place the traditional way, kind of like going through an estate agent's paperwork takes weeks. Like, he didn't want to live with his ex-boyfriend for that long. So instead, Gabriel wrote on his Grindr profile, which if you don't know what Grindr is, it is a dating app, but specifically for gay people. He wrote on his Grindr profile that he was looking for a room to rent as soon as possible, and he found one. A man named John Pip messaged him offering up his spare room, and so the two of them met up, they got on well, and they decided it would be a good fit for Gabriel to move in, and so he did. John described Gabriel as smart, sweet-natured, with an infectious smile, and the two of them became really good friends while he was living there. And then 6 weeks later, out of nowhere, Gabriel just said to John that he'd be moving out. He'd found somewhere else and he'd be gone by the next morning. And John recalled thinking that this was really sudden and he was really curious as to who Gabriel had found to move out with, but he didn't want to ask too many questions. He didn't want to pry. All Gabriel told him was that it was a man that he'd met on a dating site, just like John was once. And so Gabriel left. After he left, John just kind of got on with his life as normal. The two of them kind of kept in touch. And then a couple of days later, not even a week after Gabriel had moved out, John got a knock on the door and it was the police. 22-year-old Gabriel Cavari was found dead in the graveyard of St. Margaret's Church in Barking in East London. And all police told John was that Gabriel's death was unexplained, leaving him with obviously a lot of questions. Was it suicide? Did he die of exposure? Like, What happened? What do you mean unexplained? Gabriel was found by a woman walking her dog in this graveyard, and she said that he was kind of kneeling, facing a wall, kind of leant on the wall, partially clothed. Like, he didn't look like he'd dressed himself, and the jumper that he was wearing was pulled up. He was also wearing sunglasses, but they weren't on his head properly. Like, there was nothing normal about the way that Gabriel Cavari was found. But police decided not to look into it and not to do an autopsy to find out how he died, because it didn't seem suspicious. And John was understandably angry and hurt, because this was his friend. It does seem suspicious. This is not a normal way to die in an unexplained way. And John felt that it was just unfair to Gabriel to leave his legacy so kind of unfinished, to not find out how he died or what happened. And so if police weren't gonna look into it, John decided to look into his own friend's death. So he went to his laptop and he searched unexplained deaths in Barking, and sure enough, Gabriel wasn't the only one. Just 2 months prior to this, another young man, 23-year-old Anthony Walgate, was found dead also in unexplained circumstances on Cook Street. So John went to Google Maps and he typed in Cook Street, and it was two streets away from the graveyard where Gabriel was found. And immediately John was very worried, very suspicious. The circumstances were far too similar. Two young men died in unexplained circumstances in very close proximity of each other. So just for a little bit more about Anthony Walgate and kind of who he was a 23-year-old fashion student from Hull all the way up in Yorkshire. Anthony was known as the life and soul of the party. He had a real zest for life. His family described him as outgoing, funny, caring. He could brighten anyone and everyone's day. He was passionate, he was driven, he was ambitious. He knew exactly what he wanted from life. And he was well on his way to going and getting it. But on June 19th, 2014, Anthony Walgate's life was cut short when he was found dead outside an apartment block in Barking. A man that lived inside this apartment block named Stephen Port was actually on his way home from working the night shift, and he was the one to discover Anthony sat outside the apartment block dead. So police arrived and pronounced Anthony dead at the scene, although some of the police remember thinking, this might be a bit suspicious. There was blood and bruising on his torso. However, police still logged his death as unexplained. And again, police decided not to really investigate it, not to do an autopsy, because it didn't seem suspicious, even though he had blood and bruising on his torso. To me, that is suspicious. And you're really gonna get mad at the Barking and Dagenham police in this case. Like, the police work in this case is some of the worst I have ever seen, and I have covered a lot of cases. So police contacted Anthony's family, who lived almost 200 miles north of this, and they informed them of his passing. And as you can imagine, they had a lot of questions. First of all, Anthony, just like Gabriel, was a fit, healthy young man with no kind of health conditions. Like, how does someone like that just drop dead without any kind of signs as to how they died? And secondly, why was he on the other side of the country when he lived and studied up north in Hull? Why was he found dead with no explanation in London? So his mother suggested to police, well, why don't you track his phone? That might tell us why he was down there. And then in turn, that might help to explain his kind of sudden death. But again, tracking his phone, just like doing an autopsy, would be too expensive. Even with potential signs of foul play, bruising and blood on his torso, it would be too expensive to find potentially who did this to him. After a lot of begging from the family, police did eventually look on his phone months after his death. However, we'll talk a bit more about that later. Anyway, back to the timeline. John Pape had just found that there was a very, very similar death to his friend Gabriel's. So John contacted Gabriel's ex-boyfriend Thierry, since he was the only person that Gabriel had ever spoken about. He was the only person that he knew that Gabriel knew. And he just wanted to inform him of Gabriel's death, because obviously Gabriel had moved here from Slovakia by himself, so he didn't have any kind of family or next of kin or anything. That was John. So John just kind of wanted to let someone know that knew Gabriel. Maybe Thierry could contact his family. And as the two of them were talking, Thierry informed John that a third young gay man, a friend of Gabriel's, had also been found dead in unexplained circumstances in the same cemetery that Gabriel was found. But not just the same cemetery, the exact same place in that cemetery, and also sat in the exact same position. This man was 21-year-old Daniel Whitworth, an aspiring chef from Kent. So John Pape at this point needed no more convincing that these were all linked and they were all suspicious. And so he got a little bit more information from Thierry. Well, actually, it was another man telling Thierry who was telling John. And this other man was claiming to have known both Gabriel and Daniel when they were alive. And this person was telling Thierry, who was telling John, that Gabriel and Daniel frequently attended what's known as chemsex parties. And chemsex parties are essentially just massive drug-fueled orgies where everyone's on so many different kinds of drugs, but all mainly GHB, which is a sex drug. And as this guy explained it to Thierry, it was essentially just older men giving younger men drugs, or sometimes drugging them without their knowledge, and then having sex with them. And this sex was not always consensual. The younger ones would often pass out from the amount of drugs that the older ones gave them, because the younger ones don't really know their limits and they just kind of take whatever's given to them, and they would pass out. And then when they wake up, often people are taking advantage of them as they were asleep. Obviously, that's not me saying that, that's not me explaining these parties. That was how This man explained it to Thierry, who explained it to John. And Gabriel supposedly attended these parties with Daniel, and then subsequently both of them turn up dead in the exact same place, in the exact same position, in the exact same circumstances. So John's immediate theory is that obviously something must be happening at these parties, be it accidental overdoses or maybe something much more sinister. And if it was something much more sinister, John was getting very concerned that maybe he would be targeted just for being friends with Gabriel. Since Daniel was a friend of Gabriel's, maybe it was someone specifically going after Gabriel and his group. And so John took all this information to the police, these three connected deaths, and said, look, are you looking into this properly? These look linked. This is my theory. So police just kind of looked over this information that John brought in and they said, okay, we'll speak to our higher ups and we'll get back to you. And they never did. And John felt as though he had a really solid lead for them. Like, he'd connected three unexplained deaths and he had a motive and he had a theory. He felt like he was really onto something, but police just weren't listening to him, and so he went to the media instead. Specifically LGBT media. He went to a website called Pink News and a website called Gallup, both of which have links to the police. So Gallup went to Barking and Dagenham police and they said, look, we've got a man here, John Pape, who has a theory that Gabriel and Daniel were friends, they were at this same chemsex party, something happened where both boys were killed. Do you want to speak to John about this? Do you want to hear more about his theory? And police said no. They didn't want to speak to John Pip because they didn't think the deaths were linked and they also didn't think it was suspicious. So at this point, John had hit a brick wall. He'd tried so many different things. Police just weren't listening. Even to people with more influence than him, the media, police just didn't really want to hear anything about John's theory. And he literally couldn't do anything more. He'd done everything he possibly could. He'd gone to higher authority, but there was nothing more he could do. And months went by and absolutely nothing was done because, like I said, police didn't think it was suspicious or linked, so they just weren't working on it. That was until they finally decided to do an inquest into the deaths of Gabriel Cavari and Daniel Whitworth. And obviously John Pape being Gabriel's like closest next of kin type thing, he was invited along with Daniel's parents. So John arrived at this inquest hearing and he recalled the detective on the case just being very messy, just disorganized, unprepared. He just didn't seem to be doing his job properly at all. So at one point, the coroner asked the detective to get out Gabriel Cavari's phone records to see if there was any connection between him and Daniel, to see if they were actually friends. And the detective kind of frantically flipped through his ring binder. He was looking at all his pages. He didn't know where it was. And then he looked up at the coroner and said, I can't find it. And so they just had to move on, because the detective was so unorganised. Had he been able to find those phone records, had he organised himself and done his job properly, then they might have found a link between Gabriel and Daniel, and that might have solved this case so much quicker. But of course, they let a huge lead slip by just because of police incompetence. The coroner then announced that they'd actually found a suicide note on Daniel Whitworth's body, and this was the first that John had ever heard of a suicide note. So I'm gonna read you out the whole thing just so that you can get the vibe of it. I was gonna do like little snippets of it, but you need to get the whole thing in context because this is insane. I am sorry to everyone, mainly my family, but I can't go on anymore. I took the life of my friend Gabriel Klein. We was just having some fun at a mate's place and I got carried away and gave him another shot of G. I didn't notice while we was having sex, but he'd stopped breathing. I tried everything to get him to breathe again, but it was too late. It was an accident, but I blame myself for what happened, and I didn't tell my family I went out. I know I would go to prison if I go to the police, and I can't do that to my family, and at least this way I can be with Gabriel again. I hope he will forgive me. By the way, please do not blame the guy I was with last night. We only had sex and then I left. He knows nothing about what I have done. I have taken what G I had left with sleeping pills, so if it does kill me, it's what I deserve. Feeling dizzy now as I took 10 minutes ago, so hoping you understand my writing. I dropped my phone on the way here, so it should be in the grass somewhere. Sorry to everyone. Love always, Daniel PW. And that suicide note, like I said, it's just insane. It's just insane. And when they first heard this suicide note, John and Daniel's family, just like I'm sure you're all thinking now, That is so suspicious. First of all, the very obvious kind of blame me, it's my fault, it's no one else's fault, no one else had anything to do with this. It was focused way more on Gabriel than it was himself, even though it was his own suicide note. There was also no mention of his family, no part of it was addressed to his family, no I love yous. It was just very cold and factual. It wasn't personal. Like, he was talking about details about how he dropped his phone. No part of that suicide note was personal to Daniel Whitworth. Anyone could have written that. And then, of course, that don't blame the guy I was with last night is just the most suspicious thing you could possibly read in a suicide note confessing to someone else's death. Of course, it brought up a lot of suspicion. Who was this guy that Daniel was with the night before? And police just said that they don't know and they don't think they'll ever know because how can you? It's just a no. But Daniel's family felt like police just weren't looking hard enough. What about CCTV? What about going and trying to find his phone that he supposedly dropped? What about like asking about in the LGBT scene in that area? Like, surely someone's got to know something or have seen him. And Daniel's family were rather confused about the handwriting in the note. It didn't seem like Daniel's. Daniel lived quite far away from his parents, so fair enough, most of the communication between them was through text and through emails, so they never really saw his handwriting all that often. But they did have an old birthday card to compare it to, and I'll just show you the comparisons here. To me, they are nothing alike. So police told Daniel's family that they would send it off for some professional analysis and come back to them on whether this was Daniel's handwriting or not, but they never did again. But they actually went one step further than that. They actually wrote on file of Daniel's kind of death file case. They wrote that his parents had confirmed that the writing in the suicide note was Daniel's handwriting, when they never confirmed that. They were the ones that were suspicious. And another thing came out in this inquest that, again, his parents weren't told about. Daniel's body was actually found on a blue sheet in this cemetery. And so the parents were saying, well, have you tested this sheet for like DNA or fingerprints or anything? But of course, no, they hadn't. They actually said they hadn't DNA tested this sheet that Daniel was found on because they never felt the need. Which, if you were gonna go and commit suicide, why would you take a blue bedsheet to go and sit on? Like, if you're doing that for like comfort purposes or something, you'd take a blanket or a cushion, not a thin blue bedsheet. To me, that looks as if it was used to transport the body, maybe. But not only that, Daniel's body was also found with bruising under his arms and all over his chest, consistent with if someone was to pick up his body and move it. And if you remember, Anthony Walgate, the first body to be found, the one that actually wasn't found in the cemetery like the other two were, his body was also found with bruising on the torso, which is yet another link between these people being found dead. But for some reason, police just couldn't seem to piece this case together, and in my opinion, it looked more as if they didn't want to piece the case together. It was all right there in front of them. They could have done it, but they chose not to, in my opinion. So after the inquest, both Gabriel's and Daniel's deaths were ruled an open verdict, which meant that foul play couldn't be ruled out, but they weren't going to investigate it further. It was just unexplained still. And once again, that was that, and the families just kind of had to live with it. They couldn't do anything about it, which must have been awful to know that their loved one was never going to get any justice, because that was it now. Their deaths had been ruled unexplained. It must have been extra hard as well for the families, not only getting no explanation for their loved one's death, but also when there's so much evidence to say that someone else did this to them, but police just didn't care. Months later, in September of 2015, so over a year after the first two deaths, Anthony and Gabriel, John Pape received an email. This email was from Barking and Dagenham Police saying that a fourth body had been found. Again, very similar victim profile, very similar circumstances, unexplained death in the same cemetery. This fourth victim was 25-year-old Jack Taylor, who went on a night out on the Saturday evening and never returned home. And by the following Monday morning, police were round at his family's home telling them that he'd passed away. Jack's sisters describe him as caring and funny, and even though he was the youngest of all the siblings, he acted kind of more like an older brother to his older sisters, like protecting them and things. So like I said, he was found in the same spot in the same graveyard, and even without an autopsy, which, you know, is too expensive for police to carry out in this case for some reason, even without an autopsy, police were pretty sure how he died this time. This time it wasn't unexplained. Police found a syringe in his pocket and a needle mark in his arm, and so they just assumed that he had overdosed on drugs, be it accidentally or possibly on purpose. And as soon as Jack's family heard that, they immediately knew, no way. No way has he taken drugs. Jack Taylor was very, very anti-drugs. He hated other people doing them. He wouldn't let any of his friends do them. He'd never touched them in his life. He was so anti-drugs. And his family said that to police. They said, no, we're not accepting that as an explanation for Jack's death because he would never touch drugs. He just wouldn't. And so police told his family that they'd investigate it a little bit more, and his family waited and waited and waited for almost 2 weeks until they finally had to contact police for any updates, just say, what's going on? Are you looking into this? And the reason that police hadn't been in touch with them for 2 weeks with updates or anything is because they weren't investigating it. They just told his sisters, we're not going to investigate this. They didn't seem to believe Jack's family saying that he was so anti-drugs because, I mean, a lot of people that take drugs wouldn't openly tell their family that they take drugs. They might pretend to be anti-drugs in front of their family and then go and do them with their mates on a weekend or whatever. But this wasn't just a case of someone being like, oh, I don't like drugs, I personally would never take them. Jack was so passionate about this. He was so anti-drugs that it was just completely out of this world that he would ever even touch them. He wouldn't. And due to police incompetence and unwillingness to listen, just like John Pape, his sisters began investigating Jack's case themselves from home. So they physically wrote everything they knew out on paper in front of them. Every little piece of evidence, every little fact. They searched for other deaths in the area, and of course they found Anthony's, Gabriel's and Daniel's. And as soon as they did, his sisters knew there had to be a connection. They asked police multiple times, are any of these boys connected? Is Jack connected to these boys? And time again, police would say, no, they're not connected and they're also not suspicious. And finally, after a lot of begging from Jack's sisters, police finally decided to look into this case a little bit more. So they checked his phone and they found that that night that he went missing, the night that he probably died, he arranged to meet up with a man embarking through Grindr. Although suspiciously, when police were looking through this phone and through his Grindr messages and everything, the account that he'd been messaging, this man that he went to meet up with, had actually deleted his profile. So police couldn't look into it. Although for some reason, that wasn't much of a red flag for police. Even though to anyone looking at this case, that would be a huge red flag. He met up with this boy died, and suddenly the account's gone. That is the biggest red flag. But of course, Barking and Dagenham police did not care, in my opinion. So they went and looked at the CCTV footage of the area where they'd planned to meet up, and sure enough, they saw Jack on that CCTV with a tall blonde man. But police said that they didn't know who the man was, and there was no way of finding out who he was because his account had gone, and how else do you find out who a man is? So this CCTV footage showed Jack and this man walking down this road until they're out of the view of CCTV cameras. So after these two men go out of the sight of this CCTV camera, a couple of minutes later, Jack is supposedly seen, police said that Jack is supposedly seen on another CCTV camera walking alone in the direction of the cemetery where he was found dead. And this to police proved that the two men parted ways on that kind of blind spot where there was no cameras, and so this man can't have been responsible for his death. It seemed as though Jack was going there by himself to possibly take his own life. So this blind spot where the men weren't seen actually had another road turning off of it. So for example, say the men are walking down here, and then this all here is the blind spot. There is actually a turning that comes out of the road. So surely there's a possibility that they could have come out of there. But then police are saying, like, the two men walked down here, they got to the blind spot, they separated ways, and then Jack was seen walking by himself to the cemetery along this bit of the road. And so his sisters are saying to police, well, surely there's a possibility that they both went that way off of this road, and then that's just another man that you're thinking is Jack walking towards the cemetery. But police were saying, no, there's absolutely no chance that they left that junction there. Maybe the other man did, but Jack is definitely seen on that other piece of CCTV walking towards the graveyard. So anyway, maybe a week later, another sergeant was introduced into the case, a brand new pair of eyes, because clearly the police that were already on this case were not doing a very good job, in my opinion. And possibly the victims' families had complained so much that maybe they got someone else in to have a look and see if these cases were connected. And so Jack's sisters saw an opportunity there. This was a new person that hadn't been influenced by all these other police officers, and so they went straight to him, they told him their theory and said, can you look into this? And so he said to Jack's sisters, yep, okay, I will look into the possibility of him maybe turning off that road in the blind spot. And of course, they found CCTV of Jack turning left in that blind spot with the man. So that person on the CCTV footage heading towards the cemetery was not Jack, but police told his family that it was, because in my opinion, they just wanted to get this case over and done with. They just wanted it closed. So his sisters said to police, well, can we release an image of this man that Jack was with to the public? Can we put it on the news and things to see if anyone recognises him? But police said no, because Jack's death was officially ruled as an open verdict. It wasn't a murder. It wasn't, they weren't looking for a suspect. And footage is only really released to the public when they're looking for a suspect. But Jack's sisters would not take no for an answer. They wanted that picture on the news, and honestly, his sisters were amazing in this case. Their names were Donna and Jen, and honestly, they were the ones that solved this case. And with a lot of persuasion, this image was finally released to the public, and thank God it was, because within 48 hours, they had someone arrested and in police custody. On October 15th, 2015, 41-year-old Stephen Port was taken into police custody on suspicion of all four murders. Stephen was born in Southend-on-Sea on February 22nd, 1975, and at 1 year old, his family moved to Dagenham. In school, Stephen was bullied. He didn't have very good social skills. He was remembered as quite a loner. He didn't have many friends. He eventually went on to get his own flat in Barking, and he got a job as a chef at a bus station. And his neighbour at this flat recalled him being very childlike. Like, in his 40s, he would sit at a party and play with children's toys. When everyone around him is like drinking, talking, being adults, he's sat playing with a plastic fire truck on the floor. And this neighbour, we're going to be talking about this neighbour quite a bit, he was very aware that Stephen Port took drugs pretty much daily. And that included cocaine, crystal meth, MCAT, GHB and poppers. But not just that, those were just the most common ones. And this neighbour witnessed Stephen Port just hoarding drugs in his flat. Like, he had way more than for just personal use. And it's not like he sold drugs or anything, he would just buy them and keep them, and his collection just kept growing and growing and growing as he was still taking them as well. This neighbour also witnessed Stephen Port having young men round at his flat constantly. He actually described it as one after another after another. And Stephen mainly attracted these men through like dating websites and dating apps and occasionally paying for escort services. He never really went out and found something organically. Like, he never really wanted to leave his flat other than for work. Stephen's type was slim, well-groomed, typically more effeminate, young, sometimes too young. They were like 16, 17, 18. His neighbour described them as more like vulnerable. Like, you know when you just talk to someone and you can tell that they're quite immature in how they come across? Like, they're not a fully developed adult yet, because they weren't adults. And on the odd occasion that Stephen would have a more long-term relationship, obviously all of them broke up, and this neighbour witnessed all of those breakups. And through them, he saw a complete different side to Stephen. The first ex-boyfriend that this neighbour witnessed said that he'd actually split up with Stephen because Stephen had pushed him into a TV and he didn't like that. The next ex-boyfriend said that he split up with Stephen because he hit him during an argument. And after that, as these boyfriends kept coming and going, the reasons for them splitting up with Stephen got more and more violent, more and more scary and abusive. So now police had Stephen Port back at the police station being charged with all four murders, yet he was maintaining his innocence. One thing that immediately came out in this case was that Stephen Port had actually served prison time earlier that year in connection with Anthony Walgate's death. And I don't know if police even told Anthony's family that this had happened, but when you hear this, you are gonna be so angry that they didn't just catch him then and there at the first murder. So if you remember right back to the beginning of this video, Anthony Walgate was found by a man coming home from his night shift and arriving back at his apartment block, and he found him dead on the floor outside. Well, that was Stephen Port. And when police arrived, he told them that he didn't know this guy, he'd never seen him before, he'd literally just come home from his night shift and found him there outside, dead on the floor. So police let him go and they never thought about it again. They believed his story and everything. But then months and months later, when police were looking into Gabriel and Daniel's deaths, they decided to also check Anthony Walgate's phone history. On Anthony's phone, they found that he used to work part-time as an escort through a website named sleepyboys.com. And as they looked through his messages on this website, they found that Anthony was actually on a job at the time of his death. An overnight stay arranged with Stephen Port. And police at the time didn't find this very suspicious. I mean, now looking at it in retrospect, it is obviously so suspicious. But because Anthony died of a GHB overdose, which is a sex drug, and he was on an escort hookup job at the time, police just thought this was an accidental death caused by the drugs during consensual sex. They didn't think that this was murder. And they thought that maybe Stephen Port just didn't want to admit his connection to Anthony Walgate, maybe because he was embarrassed at buying escort services, or maybe he was still closeted and he didn't want to tell police that he was gay or whatever, and so Stephen maybe just thought it was easier to act as though he didn't know Anthony. But even though police didn't suspect murder, it's still a crime to hide information from police, to lie to police, and so Stephen Port was convicted of perverting the course of justice. He was sentenced to 8 months in prison but only served 3 months of that, and over that 3 months there were no more deaths. So that is certainly something that police should have paid more attention to. He was released in late June, and then by September, the fourth body was found. So police, it should have just been so obvious to police. Obviously, because they didn't consider Anthony Walgate's death a homicide, they did none of the usual kind of evidence collecting that they would normally. So they didn't go and look at Stephen Port's flat because it wasn't a homicide. There's not going to be any evidence in there of a homicide. But had they just searched Stephen's flat then and there, they would have found his huge stash of drugs that was way more than for just personal use, all of the drug that Anthony overdosed on. Like, that is yet another connection here that police are just missing. So to find evidence that Stephen Port was connected to these boys at some point, they recovered his phone and looked back through like phone records, dating app chat logs and things. One of the things that they found on his phone was that Stephen Port actually had a fake Facebook profile named John Luck. And if you remember, way back towards the beginning of this video, I told you that a man was telling Thierry some information about these chemsex parties, and Thierry was telling John Pape. Well, that person that was telling Thierry was John Luck. He was claiming that he was friends with Gabriel and he was friends with Daniel, and they would all go to these chemsex parties together, so that's probably what happened. He was covering his tracks. But in reality, neither of them ever attended these chemsex parties, neither Daniel nor Gabriel. It was just Stephen Port as John Luck trying to make out like they did. And through his chat logs on Grindr, police found that Stephen Port had spoken to Gabriel Cavari about him renting a room in his flat. Which, if you remember, Gabriel did say to John Pape that he'd found a man on a dating website to go and live with, and that was Stephen Port. After Gabriel had moved in, Stephen texted his neighbour saying, "Hey neighbour, come meet my new Slovakian twink flatmate tonight or tomorrow." And so this neighbour went round the next day. Although Stephen wasn't in, he went inside and spoke to Gabriel for a bit, and the two of them, Gabriel and the neighbour, established a friendship. After meeting him that day, this neighbour texted Stephen Port saying, "Oh, I met him, he was really nice and everything." And Stephen Port texted him back saying, "I'm taking good care of him, hee hee." And within days of those text messages, Gabriel went missing. Suddenly, Gabriel had stopped replying to the neighbour's text messages, and so the neighbour texted Stephen saying, what's going on? Is Gabriel okay? He's not answering any of my texts. And Stephen said to the neighbour, oh, actually, I haven't seen him for a couple of days either. Maybe he's run off with an army man that he met online that he spoke about a couple of times. And then a couple of days later, Stephen texts the neighbour saying that he's got some bad news. Supposedly, Gabriel had gone back to Slovakia, picked up a serious illness, and died within days. He also said to the neighbour, whatever you do, don't post about this on Facebook because his family is still grieving and you don't want to make it any worse for them being reminded that he's passed. And unbelievably, that cover story actually worked. Like, despite Gabriel's body being found just two streets away from this neighbour, he always just believed that Gabriel had gone back to Slovakia and died of an illness. So as police continued looking through this Grindr account that he'd actually deleted, Stephen Port had deleted this Grindr account, they looked through more chat logs and they found a connection between Stephen and the fourth victim, Jack Taylor. And if you remember, Jack was the one that was messaging this man on Grindr, they planned to meet up and then they were seen on all this CCTV footage. Well, the Grindr account that Jack had been messaging was actually deleted, and so they couldn't find out who it was, so there was no way of finding out who this man on the CCTV was. Well, that deleted account belonged to Stephen Port. So all of this information from his phone records proved that he knew the boys and he had a connection with the boys, but what proved that he actually killed them? Well, police took Stephen Port's laptop and had a look through his search history, and that revealed at least a motive for wanting to kill these boys. And Stephen Port had searched for the following terms: date rape drug, unconscious boy rape videos, boys being drug raped, and unconscious porn videos. And then right after he searches all of those things, Stephen Port goes on to sleepyboys.com and books Anthony Walgate's escort services. So it's very, very clear there, based on that pattern of his internet history, exactly what his intentions were with Anthony Walgate. But still, that doesn't quite make him guilty of the murders. It gives him a motive for wanting to commit the murders, but where is the proof that he actually did this to these boys? So police went and forensically tested some things that should have been tested a long, long time ago, when they first came up, when these deaths first happened. But first of all, the needle that was found in Jack Taylor's pocket, the needle that he supposedly injected himself with and killed himself with, was not used. So how on earth could Jack have gone and sat in this cemetery and given himself a fatal injection of drugs and killed himself with a needle that wasn't even used? Police's theory just does not make sense. Had police just looked at this needle at the time, they would have been able to solve this case so much quicker than they did. So as for each individual murder, let's talk about the evidence that we have for each individual boy. As for Anthony Walgate, we have evidence that he was with him on the night that he died because Stephen booked his escort services for that night. Why else would he be down in Barking if he lived in Hull? Like, he wasn't just around in that area, he was down for that escort service. And the search history on Stephen Port's computer right before he booked Anthony's services shows what his intentions were in booking those services. As for Gabriel Cavari, he was living with Stephen Port at the time of his death. He lied about how Gabriel died to his neighbour. He tried to cover it up by telling his neighbour not to post about it, and also by messaging Thierry, Gabriel's ex, saying, oh, he was into chemsex parties, like, that's probably how he died. And as for Jack Taylor, the CCTV proves that he was with Stephen Port on the night of his death, and the needle that he supposedly killed himself with was not used, so he didn't administer himself that fatal overdose. But what about Daniel Whitworth, the third death, the kind of final piece in the puzzle? So if you remember, Daniel was the one that had supposedly killed Gabriel Cavari by accident and then killed himself out of remorse, and he left that suicide note, although the handwriting was off. Well, police went back and forensically tested this supposed suicide note and found Stephen Port's fingerprints all over it. Not only that, but if you remember, his body was also found on a blue sheet, which I said my own personal theory is that he was transported using that. Well, they finally tested that blue sheet and found Stephen Port's DNA all over it once again. So now it was very, very clear that Stephen Pott was a serial killer and he was responsible for all four of these boys' deaths. So police went to him with all of this evidence that they had and they said, look, this is not looking good against you. You can just confess now and we don't have to go through all this questioning. But Stephen Pott protested his innocence. He did admit to knowing and sleeping with all four men. Obviously, he can't dispute the DNA evidence, CCTV, like chat logs and things. He said he knew and slept with all four of them, but he said that he never murdered anyone. He insisted that all four of these deaths were accidental. And according to Stephen Pott, they were all just a result of accidental overdose during chemsex. He said because the boys were young, they weren't that experienced in GHB and like the effects of it and everything, they didn't know how much they could handle and they all just accidentally overdosed themselves on it. And he said that this happened with every single one of those four boys, and we don't really have the specifics for three of them. However, Anthony Walgate, he told like a full story of how that one went down. So Stephen said that when Anthony arrived at his flat for these kind of escort services, he had already taken some GHB. And as soon as he got there, he went to the bathroom and administered himself some more. He then said that Anthony was violently ill for hours. He was throwing up everywhere and he still wasn't done throwing up by the time that Stephen had to go to work. And so he just kind of put him in his bed to sleep it off, and then Stephen went to work on his night shift, and then when he came back the following morning, that was when he supposedly found Anthony dead outside. And this was supposedly kind of how all of them went. They'd all kind of taken drugs and then taken even more drugs and then they got ill and then died. That's how all four of them happened, supposedly. And Stephen even said to a pen pal that he had that because he witnessed these four horrible drug overdoses, accidental overdoses, that Stephen was going to become an anti-drugs activist and he was going to start giving talks. Which is just so obviously a cover-up, because Stephen himself did drugs. He had so many in his flat. He was just using that to kind of pad up this story that it was accidental. But of course, that's not how any of these interactions actually went down with these boys. So obviously, the victims aren't here to tell the story of what actually happened. The only other person that knows what happened with each of those four boys is Stephen Pott, and he maintains his innocence, so he's obviously not telling police what actually happened with them. However, multiple people have come out since this case has come out and Stephen's been outed as this horrible man. Several people have come forward with allegations against him that they went through a very similar thing but survived. And one of these survivors included a young Muslim boy that he met just a couple of days before Anthony Walgate. So this boy could have potentially been the first murder. The two of them, this boy and Stephen Pott, began messaging on a website named Fit Lads, and they agreed to meet up, and this boy went to his house where Stephen persuaded him to take poppers. And due to this boy's religion, he had never taken drugs, he had never drank a sip of alcohol, he didn't want to take these poppers, but he said that something felt threatening about Stephen that day. He didn't quite know what it was. He wasn't like physically threatening him, but he felt like he had to take them. And so he took these poppers and passed out. And then when he woke up again, Stephen Pott offered him a glass of water, which to him did not taste like water. This boy said he began to feel partially paralyzed after he drank this water. And when he looked down, he noticed that he was completely naked from the waist down, which obviously he hadn't done himself. And unfortunately, even though this boy survived, he never went to police about it because he was scared. He was still closeted in his sexuality and he had a very strict religious family and he just felt as though he couldn't come out. So telling police for him wasn't really an option. And police believe that this is exactly what Pott did with each of his other four victims that he successfully killed. He would either threaten them, offer them, or just spike them with drugs. And then when they pass out from this, he would rape them and then give them the final fatal dose that killed each of his victims. And police believe that this final fatal dose was most likely administered while they were still passed out. In November of 2016, Stephen Pott went on trial for a number of different charges, including the rape and murder of all four men. This also included the rape of three other men, that obviously came forward after Stephen Port was in the news and everything. 10 counts of administering a substance with intent, so drugging someone in order to be able to do something, and 4 further counts of sexual assault. He was found guilty of every single charge that I just listed, and he was sentenced to a whole life tariff, meaning that he is never going to be out of prison. And of course, it would not be a serial killer video unless they tried to appeal their sentence, which is exactly what he did in 2008. He tried to appeal the murder charges, still sticking to his story that this was accidental, like it was an accidental overdose during chemsex. Of course, this appeal was rejected because there is just so much evidence that it was not accidental. So I'm sure we can all agree that the police work in this case was absolutely dreadful, and none of those people working on that case should be police officers if they cannot do their job properly. And they have come under a lot of fire from the media, from the public. Like, everyone is so pissed off at how they handled this case, rightfully so. And a lot of people, including Anthony Walgate's own mother, have accused these officers working on the case of being homophobic. Some people consider it maybe not homophobia, but just a prejudice towards gay people that they need educating on. And other people are saying this is straight up homophobia, they were doing this on purpose because these were gay men being killed and they didn't care because of that. And that's why a lot of people believe the police didn't care about any theories in this case. It was very cut and dry to them. All of these cases were just chemsex parties or suicides. And that's why a lot of people believe they didn't give any time to any different kind of theories. Even though John Pip literally handed them mountains of evidence and a full theory as to how all of these were connected, police just couldn't be bothered looking into it, in my opinion. And a lot of people do believe that that is because the police were either homophobic or had a prejudice against gay people, which a lot of people would agree is homophobia. In my opinion, they were very dismissive of this case, very dismissive of the victims' families. Was it because they're homophobic? Maybe. I don't know, but was it because they were terrible at their job? Yes, absolutely. Had they not listened to Jack Taylor's sisters when they were begging them to look into this case, Stephen Port would still be out there. I have no doubt about that, because police were not going to treat this as anything other than gay people going to parties and overdosing on drugs. But had they just listened to John Pape in the first place, there would have only been 2 deaths rather than 4. To me, there is a very clear prejudice. A lot of people are saying if these were women being found dead in a graveyard in the same place under the same circumstances, would it have been handled this way? I truly believe that had these been women, they would have had it solved after the first or second death. It would have never got this far, but because they were gay men, I don't know, that's just what I believe. But yeah, thank you so much for watching Valencrimes Week. It's been really good. I've really enjoyed like spending almost every day with you guys. But yeah, thank you so much for watching this video. If you enjoyed, make sure you leave a big thumbs up and subscribe down below if you want to see some more from me. A huge thank you to all of my channel members. All of their names are on screen right now. If you want to become a channel member, you can just click the link in the description, or if you're on a desktop, you can click the join button under the video. If you become a channel member, you'll get your name on this end card, and you'll also have access to a members only community tab where I will ask for case suggestions, do polls to see what cases come next, and you can just have a lot more say in what you see on the channel. But yeah, thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next one that won't be Valencrimes themed, maybe. I don't know. A lot of the cases I cover on this channel do tend to be like relationship-y, romantic type cases. I don't know. But yeah, I'm trying to say bye. I've been trying to say bye for so long, but for some reason I keep talking. It's 2 in the morning. I need to go to bed. Bye.